connection with mixtures such as the mixed stains in the Bronco and stain 78. Last week, the court ruled that statistics must be presented in connection with those mixtures so that the jury would know what to make of them, what to make of the fact, for example, that Nicole Brown Simpson is included in the Bronco mixture.
I understand why I did it.
Over the weekend, we received reports from the prosecution regarding the statistics that they intend to present, and we have serious problems with them. We think that the reports that they've shown us with what they plan to do fail to comply with the court's ruling on this matter, and we have a series of objections to them that we want to state now.
Right.
I think at the time of the court's ruling last week, I think we all contemplated that the statistics in question would be frequency statistics to be computed in accordance with the National Research Council's guidelines. So, for example, to allow the jury to evaluate what it means that Nicole Brown Simpson has genotypes consistent with certain stains in the Bronco, the jury needs to know what percentage of people in the population at large have genotypes consistent with those stains and what percentage would be excluded. And the National Research Council provides a very simple, straightforward way of doing those calculations by summing the matching and non-matching genotypes. What we got from the prosecution and what they intend to present, apparently, is not frequencies, but something called likelihood ratios. Likelihood ratios are a ratio of two conditional probabilities, where a conditional probability, as you probably know, is a probability of one event calculated on the assumption that certain other events occurred. These likelihood ratios, we know of no precedent for the admission of likelihood ratios in a criminal matter. In the notice of objections we filed with the court in March, we stated a series of objections to likelihood ratios. All of the objections we stated in our previous memo apply to the likelihood ratios they're offering here, and more. We think the particular likelihood ratios that they are offering that are found in a report prepared by Professor Weir of North Carolina State University are lacking in foundation, because the assumptions that are predicate to the conditional probabilities don't necessarily jive with the facts of this case, and in some cases are clearly inconsistent with the prosecution's theory of the case. So what they've come up with is not something that complies with the court's order. It's a convoluted attempt to do an end run around the court's order and present a complex form of statistical analysis that is unprecedented and that we think is quite misleading. Should they be allowed to present this or attempt to present it, we think a 402 hearing may be necessary to evaluate whether these likelihood ratio statistics are in fact admissible. We think this is a failure to comply with the court's order. We ask that they be ordered to present the appropriate statistics computed in accordance with the National Research Council's method, or that the DNA mixture evidence be struck from the record.
All right, Mr. Clarke.
Yes, Your Honor. Again, this raises the question that I broached with the court Friday. What numbers does the defendant want? I mean, perhaps we can agree on that. But more importantly, what the defense received was materials from Dr. Bruce Weir that this witness, I believe the testimony will show, understands the calculation process, can perform it herself, and will do so. Contrary to the defense's assertion, there's no intent on our part to introduce likelihood ratios. There is a good deal of data in this report that we're referring to. It's approximately 12 pages in length, and it includes frequency information as well that I plan to elicit from Dr. Cotton during testimony.
You plan to elicit an aggregation?
Could I just a moment? For Dr. Cotton to answer the court's question instead of it being through myself as a conduit?
Certainly. It'll save some time, I suspect.
Would you like her on the witness stand?
No. Dr. Cotton, good morning. What is it that we are going to be hearing, and how will it be presented?
Let's take the RFLP separately from the PCR for a moment, although the calculations are done the same. For the RFLP, we intended to just discuss the two genetic locations where on the individual films you have evidence of a mixture that would be MS1 and G3, and to simply give the figures for what is the probability you would pick a pair of people from the population that would have this combination of genotypes that would give you this result. The same, so for the RFLP, it's simply giving that figure for the MS1 locus and giving that figure for the G3 locus. For the PCR, the figures are done likewise. That is, what is the probability you would pick a pair of individuals from the population? So it takes into account all possible pairs that could have given this this set of alleles, and sums those, and then says, what's the probability I would pick two pairs of people that could give this? In his report, Dr. Weir does provide information about likelihood ratios, but it was not our intention to discuss that.
All right, what are the numbers that we're going to get on the RFLP and the PCR aggregation?
I'll have to get those out of my briefcase. It's in my briefcase.
How about a ballpark figure?
The ballpark figures for the RFLP range sort of like 1 in 80 to 1 in it's either in the hundreds or thousands. It is not in tens of thousands. The PCR numbers are similar. The reason that they're similar is that for the RFLP, you're just looking at a single locus and giving information about that locus. The PCR you're giving the composite information across all of the loci that we have done for PCR.
All right. To give the court an example of sometimes the complexity of this, if one were to take the boot drop, item number 78, and determine what's the probability of finding the 14 bands that were located, it's, for instance, approximately 2 with about 12 zeros behind it. I mean, they're astronomical, so it all depends on how the question is framed. It's not our intent to present that type, at least during the direct examination. But I think the court's getting, and I'm sure the court's getting a feel for characterizing this question can be difficult, but I think we're, at least it's our intent to approach it in a very conservative fashion.
All right, Mr. Newfeld, any comment? Excuse me, Mr. Thompson.
Your Honor, I think it's clear from what's been said that what they're offering is not what the National Research Council called for.
All right, National Council, you have the same information before you. What numbers do you come up with? What
Well, let me show you. I prepared a chart, Your Honor, showing what we think is the correct computation with regard to stain number 29, the Bronco steering wheel. And with your permission, I could show you and counsel a copy.
Please.
Okay. Now, Your Honor, the frequencies in this chart are taken directly from Cellmark's own frequency data that was disclosed to us in discovery from DNA discovery page 1520. And in order to compute the probability or the percentage of the population that would be consistent with this mixed stain in the Bronco, all it has done is that one lists all of the possible genotypes that one could have that would be consistent with that stain, computes the frequency, or adds up the frequency of each of those genotypes in each of the relevant populations, and sums them. And so we find that among Caucasians, 45.4% of Caucasians would match stain 29, 59.2% of African Americans, 48.8% of Hispanics would be included in the stain. And the percentage excluded with the complement, simply taking these numbers and subtracting them from one. This is what the jury needs to know in order to evaluate, for example, the fact that Nicole Brown Simpson's genotypes match the stain. These statistics are not what the prosecution is offering. They're offering conditional probabilities. Even if they don't frame them as a ratio of conditional probabilities, they are still conditional probabilities. That is, the probability of one event conditioned on a set of assumptions. What Dr. Cotton discussed was the probability of a pair of people giving certain results under certain assumptions. Now, the problem is the assumptions. The conditionals that Dr. Weir computed, for example, were all conditioned on the assumption that the number of contributors to the mixed stains was two individuals and only two, and that somehow we knew that. Now, that might be an appropriate statistic in a case where we know the number of potential contributors to the stain. For example, a rape case where a woman says that she was raped by two men. But in a case like this, where we don't know the number of contributors, it is without foundation and irrelevant, prejudicial, and completely inappropriate to allow them to present statistics premised on certain assumptions when they cannot demonstrate those assumptions are true. The arguments become circular. In order to prove that the prosecution's theory of the case is correct, they offer statistics that are premised on the assumption that the prosecution's theory of the case is correct, and we go around and around in a logical merry-go-round. And that is why they're able to come up with numbers like 1 in 100 or 1 in 50 when the NRC numbers are 45%, 59%, 48%. This is not appropriate. It doesn't comply with the court's order. It's not even consistent with their own chart. Their own chart, when they list numbers, is headed frequency. They're not offering frequencies. They're offering these complex conditional probabilities premised on sets of assumptions which are going to be controversial and which I think may not match the facts of this case. For example, if the prosecution's theory of the case is correct, the number of contributors to the steering wheel stain has to be at least three. And yet, the statistics they're offering on that are probabilities premised on the notion that there are only two contributors. And the statistics ask, what's the probability that by randomly choosing two and only two people, you would produce the exact results that we see here? That's simply not relevant to the facts of this case.
Mr. Clarke?
Yes. With regard to, first of all, Mr. Thompson's characterization is wrong as to the prosecution's theory that there's three donors on the steering wheel. All that's been reported by Dr. Cotton thus far is that there are types from which two individuals cannot be excluded, and there's another allele. That is not inconsistent with two contributors. We know there's at least two because there's a mixture. It may very well be only two.
But no, I'm more interested not so much in the theory of the prosecution's case, but in the method in reaching this calculation in the first place. Have you had the opportunity to review the proposal by Professor Thompson with Dr. Cotton? Because this appears to be the aggregation that's recommended at page 59 of the NRC report.
Just very briefly, if I could, I'd like to speak with her a little bit more.
All right. When do you anticipate hitting this point in your...
That's flexible with the court's direction. If cross-examination is finished and then I can conduct my redirect, which at this point is not substantial, then perhaps, I see a smile on the court's face, then perhaps we could address this issue once Dr. Cotton and I have had a chance to discuss it.
All right, let's do that. All right, we've framed the issues. I think counsel should have the opportunity to go over with Dr. Cotton what these numbers are. Professor Thompson, do you have a similar calculation for the other stain?
I don't have it right now, Your Honor. I'd be happy to discuss with Dr. Cotton how we think that should be approached.
All right.
For that one, we need some additional data, which they have access to and maybe not.
Okay. All right, then I propose that we proceed with the jury, that probably what will occur is Dr. Cotton and Mr. Clarke will have the opportunity to confer over the lunch hour. And let's start with the jury now.
Your Honor, if I may, could I ask that Dr. Weir's report be marked as an exhibit for the court's purposes only?
Yeah, I'd like to read it over the lunch hour as well. All right, Deputy Magnaro, let's have the jurors, please. members of our jury panel. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I understand we enjoyed our weekend activities. I understand one of us was unusually lucky. All right, Dr. Cotton, would you resume the witness stand, please? All right, good morning again, Dr. Cotton.
Good morning.
You reminded, ma'am, you were still under oath, and Mr. Newfeld.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Good morning. Congratulations, sir.
Thanks.
Good morning, Dr. Cotton.
Good morning, Mr. Newfeld.
Now, what I'd like to do, Dr. Cotton, is return to item 29 briefly, which was where we left off on Friday morning. On direct examination, you had testified that the prosecutor's board was not correct because it failed to include Nicole Brown Simpson as a potential contributor to the mixed blood stain on the steering wheel. Is that correct?
That's correct.
And that's why you wrote in the name Brown?
Yes.
All right, do we need to prop that up so the jury can see what we're talking about here?
Yeah. Dr. Cotton, on Friday during cross-examination, you admitted that the number 4 allele reflects the presence of a potential third person into that mixture. Is that correct?
Objection,
Bay. Oh, well.
The 4 allele, if you assume that there are three people, the 4 allele is a third person. Alternatively, the 4 allele could just be a second person.
Well, isn't that true? In fact, with I'm sorry.
You can't tell from this data whether there's two or three people there.
In fact, in any instance where you have more than two alleles, let's say you have three or four alleles present, you can tell whether it's a mixture of two people or more than two people, correct?
That's right.
Could be three people, right?
Could be.
Could be four people.
It could be.
Right. But if we're now simply referring to the column on that board, the second to the last column says not excluded. You'd agree, I think you've already said, that Mr. Simpson cannot be excluded, correct?
That's right.
And I think you'd also said that you'd agree that Nicole Brown Simpson cannot be excluded as well, correct?
That's right.
But you're also saying that you can't exclude some other person whose identity is unknown. Isn't that correct, who possesses that 4 allele?
That's right.
So what I'd like you to do, Dr. Cotton, is to add, if you would, under the category that says not excluded, this additional card that says third person.
Let me see counsel over at sidebar, please, with the reporter. No. Let's proceed.
Thank you. Dr. Cotton, given the observed alleles on item 29, the mixed blood stain on the steering wheel, there's a category here called not excluded. You see that?
Yes.
Okay.
I'm sorry, Your Honor, may I walk through so that I can see this chart?
Sure.
And the alleles observed again on sample 29 are 1.1, correct?
Yes.
1.2, correct?
Yes.
And finally the 4.
Yes.
And if we were able to make a separate column called not excluded, you would agree, Dr. Cotton, that Mr. Simpson could not be excluded as a contributor to this mixture. Is that correct?
That's right.
So I'm going to add his name into the column of people who cannot be excluded. And would you agree that given the alleles in this mixture, that Nicole Brown Simpson cannot be excluded?
That's right. I agree.
So I'm going to add her name to the column of people who can't be excluded. Is that consistent with your testimony?
Yes.
And would you agree, Dr. Cotton, that given the presence of the 4 allele, that anyone else who has a genotype, the DQ alpha, of either 4.4, 4.1.1, or 4.1.2 also cannot be excluded?
Yes, I do.
So
that's, you're correct.
So may I add that collective person, if you will, as a third category under not excluded?
Yes, that would be another group of people that wouldn't be excluded.
Thank you. Is it consistent with your testimony if I simply describe this person as someone of either type 4.4 or 4.1.1 or 4.1.2? Is that correct?
Yes.
So, by your testimony and your observations of this DQ alpha type, then there would be these 3 different listings and under the not excluded column. Is that correct?
That's the 3 different listings you get. If you're assuming 3 contributors, you can break it down in that manner.
Oh, I'm not assuming anything.
I'm sorry. Let's finish your answer, please.
Yes.
Please do.
You could simply also make a list of all the possible genotypes that could be in there, and it would include the ones you've listed there, including the one for Mr. Simpson and the one for Nicole Brown.
In your column, where you have not excluded, you didn't make an assumption that there were simply 2 donors, did you?
No, we didn't make any assumption at all about how many donors there were.
Right. So likewise, if we don't make any assumption as to how many donors there are, in the categories of people not excluded, you would agree then with the 3 different groupings that I placed on defendants next in order, which would be what, Your Honor?
I believe it would be 1151.
1151?
1151.
Mm.
Is that correct, sir? Ma'am? Doctor? Excuse me. 1 weekend, I apologize.
Yeah, you're correct, but what I'm trying to get, the point I'm trying to get to is that if you don't make any assumptions at all about how many donors there are in there, there are genotypes that aren't on your list. You wouldn't exclude a 1-1-1-1. You wouldn't exclude a 1.2-1.2.
Well, I'm sorry, 1.1 is on the list.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Okay, you're right. You're right. Okay, I guess we have all possible.
Wait! First of all, you can't talk at the same time. Secondly, when I say wait, everybody stops, including you, Dr. Cotton, including you, Mr. Newfeld. You can't argue with the witness and with the answer that she's giving. You get to ask questions. You get to give answers, doctor. Proceed.
Thank you. With permission, Your Honor, I'd just like to be able to move the pad so the rest of the jurors can see it as well. Thank you. Now, in terms of eliminating other possible contributors to this mixed stain, Dr. Cotton, are you aware that neither Dennis Fung or Andrew Mazzola could have contributed the number 4 allele to this mixture?
Objection assumes facts not known.
It's sustained.
All right. Let me ask you a hypothetical based on a good faith basis. May I just show something to the
Honor?
May I produce
May
a document?
May we approach the bench, please?
Yes, with the court reporter. All right. Thank you, counsel. Proceed.
One moment, Your Honor. Dr. Cotton, the first samples that were sent to you by the Los Angeles Police Department were sent on or about June 22, 1994. Is that correct?
That's right.
And at least initially, the person that you were expected to contact with the results of your testing was Michelle Kessler at the LAPD. Is that correct?
She was one of the contacts, yes. There was another person who could also be a contact, if I remember correctly.
Let me just show you a document to see if it refreshes your recollection on this point. Let me ask you this question. Were you at least initially instructed by the Los Angeles Police Department that the results should be communicated to Michelle Kessler?
Yes.
And I believe on September 8, 1994, your laboratory prepared a report on DNA results, did it not?
We have a lot of reports. Which one?
One dated September 8.
Yes, 8th. I found it.
Found it?
Yes.
Okay. And that's a report written to Michelle Kessler?
That's right.
And isn't it a fact that on September 12th of 1994, Selmark actually faxed a copy of this report to Michelle Kessler at the Los Angeles Police Department?
We may have. I don't have all those records down here with me.
Perhaps I can help you.
What's next on your order? 1152.
Excuse me, 1152. I'll show you a document which has been marked since 1152, which is a five-page report, excuse me, and ask you if you can identify that document.
Yes, this is a copy of the September 8th report, and although the fax cover is not here, and I can't exactly read all the figures at the top, it seems to say from Selmark Diagnostics. I can't read any fax date on the top, however.
If you look at the next page or the page after, where it seems to be a little bit clearer.
Oh, yeah, there we go. Right, right. And the date is September 12, 1994 at 1:45.
Okay. And so that would indicate, Dr. Cotton, thank you, that this September 8th report was faxed to Michelle Kessler at the Los Angeles Police Department on September 12, 1994?
Yes.
Now, did Selmark disclose the results in that report to anyone other than Michelle Kessler during the month of September?
No.
Or will.
Did Cellmark disclose any of the results contained in that report of September 8th to anyone in the media?
Absolutely not.
Or will.
Are you aware, Dr. Cotton, that there were certain media reports on September 12th concerning the results?
Objection. Seems facts not an evidence.
It's irrelevant.
I want to ask you some questions, Dr. Cotton, about the substrate controls in this case, all right?
Sure.
Now, in this case, Andrea Mazzola testified that she created substrate control swatches for every stain that she collected at Bundy and at Rockingham. Are you aware of that, by the way?
Objection.
Rollins.
No. I've watched little bits and pieces of testimony here and there, but I have not listened to the entirety. I didn't have time to do that, so
you stated,
I'm not.
Okay. Thank you. You stated on direct examination, Dr. Cotton, that testing the substrate control swatch can be informative if the testing of that swatch reveals the presence of DNA. Is that correct?
Yes.
And would you agree that if DNA is found, one explanation could be that there was certain biological material in the area immediately adjacent to the bloodstain?
Yes, that would be the interpretation.
And would you agree that another explanation, Dr. Cotton, could be that both the bloodstain swatch and the substrate control swatch were cross-contaminated at some point after the collection of the evidence? That's another possible interpretation.
If you are testing the substrate control and you found DNA on it, then that would say that your first explanation would be correct, and the other explanation, which you just said, is that it could have been contaminated later, but it doesn't say anything about whether the actual piece of evidence was contaminated later. It only says something about that substrate control.
No, but as an expert in the field, Dr. Cotton, if you thought that there may have been a cross contamination of that substrate control, and the substrate control was handled all the way along the process with the evidentiary stains, would that at least cause you to consider the possibility in your mind that the evidentiary stains may also have been cross contaminated?
Irrelevant, also seems facts not an evidence.
Oh, rule.
It certainly would say, it would raise that possibility in your mind, but it wouldn't tell you definitely one way or the other.
Okay.
It wouldn't tell you anything.
Well, it would tell you that you should be concerned about that possibility. Is that correct?
Yes, but being concerned about it and knowing something aren't the same thing.
Well, I think you also said that you can't know for sure whether there was cross-contamination with a sample before you ever received it anyway. Isn't that right?
Of course.
Well, would you agree with the following proposition, Dr. Cotton? When a stain of blood is analyzed with PCR, it is important to analyze the unstained materials next to the stain with PCR as a control for contamination.
I know you can do that. Sometimes, depending on the nature of the evidence, it may be more important to do that than other times. We do not, in our laboratory, routinely request a substrate control. If we're requested to do one, of course we do it, but we do not routinely request one, or if we're given a big stain, we don't routinely take one, because it's not always going to be informative depending on the nature of the evidence.
So what you're saying is that it's your policy to defer to the submitting agency as to whether or not the control swatches get analyzed?
That's what we would generally do.
Now, so just getting back to the proposition that I asked you about, Dr. Cotton, would you agree that it is important to analyze the control swatch at the same time for PCR testing as you analyze the evidentiary stain?
I don't think it makes any difference if you do it one way or the other.
But do you believe it's important to do it?
Oh, well.
I'm not sure what you're asking me. Are you asking me, is it important to at the same time that you do the DNA extraction from the evidence swatch, that you do the DNA extraction from the control swatch at the same time?
Did you say on direct examination, Dr. Cotton, that it's important when you have a certain kind of control, be it a negative control or a positive control, that the control should be run in parallel to the actual evidentiary items?
Well, I said you should run a reagent blank control in parallel to the actual items.
And did you also say that you should run the amplification control in parallel to the items?
Yes, the negative reagent, the negative control that you set up at the time of amplification is always run in parallel.
And did you also say that you should run the positive control in parallel?
Yes.
To the other items of evidence?
Yes.
And you said on direct examination that another type of control that exists is this substrate control. Isn't that correct?
That's right.
So my question, Dr. Cotton, is, would you agree with the following proposition, that when the blood stain is analyzed for PCR, it is important to analyze at the same time the unstained material which makes up the substrate control?
No, I don't think it's important. I think you can do it later, and it will still give you the same information as if you do it at the same time.
So what you're saying, and correct me if I'm misstating it, Dr. Cotton, that as long as you do it later, when you do it is not critical.
That's what I'm saying.
Now, in this case, Dr. Cotton, you received bloodstained items, swatches from items 47, 49, 50, and 52 last summer. Isn't that right?
Yes.
And is it also true that when the LAPD sent you those items representing stains from the Bundy walkway, they failed to send you substrate control swatches for the same items?
Objection argumented.
Sustain. Rephrase the question.
When the Los Angeles Police Department sent you last summer the bloodstain swatches for items 47, 49, 50, and 52, did they send you the substrate control swatches for the same items?
No, they didn't.
And in October of 1994, you received the bloodstain swatches for item number 48, did you not?
You'll have to let me check my sheets first. Can you give me some kind of number that I'm looking for here, or a specific date?
October 12th, on or about October 12th. If you take a look in your report dated November 11th, 1994, you may see a reference.
Okay, great. Thank you. Okay.
So is that correct that on or about October 12th, you received two bloodstain swatches representing what was purported to represent item 48?
Yes, but I think that was the actual item 48. I got a lot of stuff here, so let me go back, okay?
Sure.
I may have created a misunderstanding and not have been as clear as I should have been in my question, and perhaps I can save some time. Isn't it true that on about October 12, 1994, that you received two bloodstained swatches which were labeled item 48 from the Los Angeles Police Department?
Yes.
Okay. And in that same shipment, did they send you the control swatch, the substrate control swatch for item 48?
Yes.
And what record do you have of that, of receiving that control swatch on that date?
We have... a login for item number 48 with a C after it.
Well, let me ask you this question. In the report that I just referred you to of the, which I referred you to, which referred to the October 12th date, didn't that say that you only received two swatches, both of which were stained?
Yes.
It doesn't refer to a unstained swatch being received in that shipment, does it?
It doesn't, but we have a statement in our... I'm sorry, I misspoke. I'm only finding the information about item 48 itself in this report, with the types from item 48.
Which would be the stain, the bloodstain portions,
that's
correct?
Right. And that's why I'm getting confused. I'm not finding what you're referring to, and I don't know if it's simply not here or I'm not finding it.
Well, there's no indication anywhere in your reports that you received the substrate control swatch for item 48 in that shipment on October 12th, isn't that right?
That's right.
And since you did not receive from the Los Angeles Police Department the substrate control swatches for those five, for the stains from the purported Bundy drops, would it be fair to say that you also did not run control swatches when you actually did the DNA testing on the evidence itself?
We didn't run any control swatches on that early set of evidence at the time that we analyzed that group of samples.
And would it be fair to say, Dr. Cotton, as an expert, that since the Los Angeles Police Department did not ship to you the substrate control swatches for the Bundy walkway stains at the same time as the evidentiary stains, that you have no knowledge regarding how these control swatches were handled since their purported collection to the present?
That would be true. However, we did receive some control swatches later, and I'd have to look at which samples those were control swatches for to say I had no knowledge.
All right, well, let's start out with the first step.
Okay.
Assuming for a moment that you did receive some control swatches much more recently, is that what you're saying?
Yes, that's what I'm
okay.
saying.
Okay. Certainly, based on the fact that you didn't receive the control swatches along with the evidentiary stains last summer and in October, would you agree that you have no knowledge regarding how those control swatches were handled since their purported collection up until the time much more recently that you received any of those control swatches?
Yes, that of course that would be the case.
And Dr. Cotton, in this case there was also testimony that by Andrea Mazzola that when she testified on August 23rd, 1994, that she had testified that she put her initials on bindles that she processed on the morning of June 14th. My question to you, Dr. Cotton, is do your records reflect that any of the bindles that you received from the Los Angeles Police Department bore Mazzola's initials?
Objection argumentative, first question.
Sustain. Phrase the question.
Do your records have Andrew Mazzola's initials on any of them? I'm sorry, do your records reflect that on the bindles that you received, whether Andrea Mazzola's initials appeared on any of those bindles.
They don't reflect whether they do or don't. That is, we wouldn't be writing that down. We would be writing down what was inside the bindle.
Did you look at the bindles yourself when they came in?
On the original pieces of evidence or the control swatches later on?
The original pieces of evidence.
We did look at them, and we, this is on the first group of stuff that we received. Yes, we did look at them.
And to the best of your recollection, isn't it a fact that Ms. Mazzola's initials were not on any of those bindles?
I don't have any specific recollection. It's not a piece of information that I would have been likely to remember.
Now, Dr. Cotton, you said that you did receive some control swatches more recently. Is that right?
Yes, we did.
And would that be in April, this past April of 1995?
Yes, it would.
And isn't it a fact, Dr. Cotton, and that would be, I'm sorry, and would that be the only time that you received any control swatches in this case?
I believe that those are the only control swatches that we received.
Okay. Would it be fair to say, Dr. Cotton, that from the very first time you received item 47 in this case until today, as you sit on this witness stand, that the Los Angeles Police Department never sent to you the substrate control swatch for item 47?
Yes, that would be correct.
And so item 47's control swatch has never been examined or tested by your laboratory?
That's right.
Would it be fair to say, Dr. Cotton, that from the time they first sent you item 48 in this case until today, as you sit on this witness stand, Los Angeles Police Department never sent you the substrate control for item 48?
That's correct.
Dr. Cotton, apparently they did send you on April 4th material labeled item 49, but doesn't say it was the item 49 control. Isn't that correct?
It didn't state on the label the word control.
It just said item 49, correct?
That's right.
All right. So do you have independent knowledge as to whether you received on April 4th the control for item 49, or did you just receive a portion of item 49?
I have photographs in the case folder of what that item looked like, but I don't have any on paper writing that says anything other than item 49.
Okay. So you have no document or record which reflects that you received the control for item 49 either in that batch. Is that correct?
That's what I just said.
Now I call your attention to item 50, the fourth of those stains at the Bundy location. From the date that you first received item number 50, the evidentiary stains, until today, as you sit here on this witness stand, have you ever received the substrate control swatch for item number 50?
No, we haven't.
Finally, for item number 52, Dr. Cotton, from the day you received the evidentiary portion of item 52 until today, as you sit here on this witness stand, has the Los Angeles Police Department ever sent to you the substrate control swatch for item 52 for DNA analysis?
No, they haven't sent it to us.
In your laboratory, Dr. Cotton, is there a standard procedure that every employee who removes or puts something into a bindle puts his or her initials on the bindle?
Yes.
And are you familiar with the practices in other laboratories, Dr. Cotton?
Not particularly.
Well, Dr. Cotton, to the extent that you have expertise in this area, would you agree that it is a standard procedure at every forensic science laboratory to have an individual who either removes or puts something into a bindle to initial that bindle?
I can really only speak for what we do in our laboratory, and when we take something in or out, the bindle is taped and initials are put across the tape and the adjacent paper.
Now, referring to another type of control, Dr. Cotton,
you mentioned something called a reagent blank. Is that right?
Yes, I did.
And is the reagent blank sometimes referred to as an extraction blank also?
Yes.
And is that because this control starts at the beginning of the processing of the sample at the laboratory when you first extract the DNA from the sample?
That's exactly right.
And am I correct in saying, Dr. Cotton, that a reagent blank is simply a tube without any DNA in it that gets processed along with all the other evidentiary samples?
Yes, generally that's what it is, or it could, on rare occasions, contain, if you had to swab a stain off of something, if we had to do that in the lab and that hadn't previously been done for us, we might include a piece of the swab before it was used. So it's not always absolutely empty, but most of the time it is.
And generally, at least in this case, that's what you meant by a reagent blank, one that was empty.
That's right.
One moment. Now, if at the end of all those steps that comprise the DNA typing procedure, Dr. Cotton, the reagent blank tests positive for the presence of DNA, it means the control failed. Is that correct?
You're putting a very black and white interpretation on there. It means that you have some DNA that was in there at some point, and that's not a term to say a control failed. That almost means to me that the control didn't provide you with the information that you need instead of did.
Well,
so I wouldn't choose that term myself.
All right.
But it does mean that you have some DNA in there that you normally would not expect to have in there.
Well, it's not just normally, Dr. Cotton. The way you run your experiment and the reason you have this reagent blank is, and the way it's run in this case, for instance, is because if the test is run correctly, there shouldn't be any DNA in the reagent blank at the end of all those steps when you analyze it. Isn't that correct?
That's exactly right, yes.
And in fact, if you do see the presence of DNA, it means that the experiment was not a success. Would you agree with that?
Well, again, it's the same thing. It's informative. It doesn't necessarily mean your results are wrong if you equate wrong with success or correctness with success. It doesn't mean your results are wrong. It does mean that you want to go back and possibly redo it, possibly, you know, relook at what you did. You might only go back if you thought something had happened just at the very last part. You might want to just go back and do the very last part. It means you want to go back and look at what you've done carefully.
Well, Dr. Cotton, if in fact you see DNA profile in the reagent blank, which is supposed to have no DNA in it, could that also mean that evidentiary specimens that were processed at the same time as the reagent blank were contaminated with some form of DNA?
It could mean that.
In fact, isn't that one of the dangers when you see a DNA profile in what should be a negative control? Isn't that an indication of the possibility that contamination or cross-contamination occurred early on in the process?
It indicates that that could have happened, yes.
In